Of last season, they pounded the run game, led by the powerful Maffa. Peyton Woodring kicks off, and it'll be a touchback. So here comes Clemson on offense, led by Cade Klubnik. As Greg said, when he arrived at Clemson, he was 178 pounds, up to a solid 210. Junior from Austin, Texas, out of the great Westlake High School program. And the numbers reflect the season he had. Some good, some bad. And a guy who can hurt you both with his arm and his feet.
He's got great ability, just has to stay within the offense and make better decisions from the get-go.
They open with Maffa, the running back, in the pistol, and four receivers. They think they'll be better in the receiving core with some players returning to health who were injured last year. Short pass and an inaccurate one. And an ominous start for Klubnik is obviously Garrett Riley, the coordinator, trying to give him an easy play to get him started, and he didn't throw a very good pass.
Yeah, they're just cranking the engine there and getting them on the move, changing the launch point, something they did very little of last year. Garrett Riley is a guy who operates from that air raid system popularized by Mike Leach, but has really grown into becoming more balanced offensively.
They fake to Maffa. There's a flag down. Jake Brenningstuhl, at 50 catches last year, powered his way to the 32, a pickup of 7 if it stands. Dan Jackson made the tackle in his 6th year in the Georgia program. Mike Roach is the referee. It's an ACC officiating crew.
Legal motion. Offense number 8 moving forward at the snap. 5-yard penalty. Second down.
Well, Dabo Swinney said eliminate the self-inflicted mistakes from a year ago. They missed a gimme pass and now a penalty on their second snap.
Just brutal start so far for Clemson's offense. Script those first 10, 15 plays, things you feel great about, most confident in, and Georgia's an elite team rushing the passer. So when you get behind the sticks and playoff schedule, you're playing into their strength.
They stick with Maffa as the running back. That's Tyler Brown, the motion man. And Brenningstuhl dropped the pass. Incomplete pass to the normally sure-handed Brenningstuhl. They finished last year with a wild win of the Gator Bowl against Kentucky, and Brenningstuhl was immense. He had 9 catches. Third down and 15. They're showing blitz. Looked like Williams was offside. There is a flag down. Klubnik gets blasted at the end of the run after some nifty footwork to get to the 25. He got hit hard by Damon Wilson. It looked like Georgia was offside.
Offside. Defense number 13. 5-yard penalty.
Michael Williams, one of many talented players on the Dog D.
And it looks like Clemson went with a bit of a hard count. In an environment like this, you can use your snap count to your advantage. He takes a big shot at the end by Damon Wilson. Gets ahead on the football, but last year, Klubnik, now a much stronger player. That one might have been on the deck in a fumble, but not today.
Kirby Smart starting his 9th season as head coach at Georgia. On 3rd and 10, the check down to Maffa, and a good tackle in the open field by KJ Bolden, a true freshman thrust into action because they're starting the game without Jonel Aguero, ordinarily their star or nickel, but he pulled a muscle earlier in the week. So Bolden starting the game, and we'll see him. See a lot of Malachi Starks, ordinarily their free safety, at the star position. Here's Aiden Swanson in his 6th year in the Clemson program, 24-year-old from Tampa. Goes up, spiral line drive punt returned by Anthony Evans out to the 32-yard line. Here's Molly McGrath on the sideline.
Well, Sean, after Georgia's loss in the SEC championship game, quarterback Carson Beck decided on this very field that he would return for a fifth and final season. He told us he was so devastated by that loss, he didn't speak to anyone for 3 days straight. And then he sat down and wrote out his goals for this season. Number one being win the national championship. Number two, he admitted, win the Heisman. Number three, be a first-round draft pick. He wrote this, posted it next to his front door, saying, every time I walk out into the world, I want to know what I'm chasing, and that chase starts here today, guys.
All of those goals very achievable for the fifth-year senior from Jacksonville. 6'4", 220-pounder off a magnificent first year as the starter last year. Flips it ahead to Arian Smith, the fastest man on their team. You asked Mike Bobo, the coordinator, last night, who do you want to get going early? And he said Arian Smith.
He's had a great offseason, kind of in and out of the doghouse last year with some inconsistency with his hands. Here, he's so athletic and dynamic with the ball in his hands, and he's always a threat to take off and get behind the defense. So getting him off to a good start, getting him feeling confident, is a big priority for Bobo.
Officially a pass and a 12-yard gain. Dominic Lovett, the motion man. And a nice tackle by DeMonte Capehart in the middle of that defensive front as he took down Branson Robinson, who starts at running back. They're replacing their top two rushers from a year ago. Dejon Edwards and Kendall Milton, both of whom went to NFL training camps. They're without Trevor Etienne, the transfer from Florida, who's likely to be their featured back. He is not playing today, suspended for a violation of university policy. He is dressed. Beck sends it out wide. Arian Smith again, and another good tackle. This one by Jaden Lucas, the cornerback.
Great tackle there by Jaden Lucas. Missed a little time in fall camp, and this is something we didn't see often for Georgia last year, is getting behind the sticks. They were one of the best teams in the country on first and second down to avoid third and longs, but here they are, first third down of the season.
Wes Goodwin, the defensive coordinator for Clemson. Georgia was best in the country on third down last year at 55%, in large part because, as Greg said, they were so good on first and second down. They didn't face many third and tens. Beck given time, now running out of it behind a veteran offensive line. He takes off running, has the first down, and stumbles down at the Clemson 43-yard line.
This is an aspect of Carson Beck's game that's very underrated. If you get too aggressive in your pass rush, he can hurt you with his legs. Doesn't like anything downfield. He has one-on-one against Wade Woodaz in the middle. He makes a miss and picks up the needed yardage.
13-yard gain. No score, 4.5 minutes in. Out wide it comes to Dylan Bell. And that's a short gain. Wade Wood has the tackle, a pickup of two. Not only is Georgia replacing their top two runners, but they lost three of their top four receivers from a year ago, including the two-time Mackey Award winning tight end Brock Bowers, who's now in the NFL as a first-round pick by the Raiders. So a lot to figure out on the offense, the skill positions around Beck. Second and eight. Branson Robinson driven back. No gain on the play. Not only did they lose Bowers, but Ladd McConkey, who was a second round pick of the Los Angeles Chargers. Rosemary Jackson, a wide receiver, went to Washington's training camp. Ra-Ra Thomas dismissed from the program. And we mentioned the top two runners. A lot of talent, but at Georgia, they typically have the best or one of the best recruiting classes in the country. Plenty of talent ready to step in. It's Cash Jones in at running back now. Back to the sideline, incomplete. And very well covered. Intended for Dylan Bell. And it's Avion Terrell, whose brother AJ was a standout at Clemson, a first round pick of the Falcons. And he's here today. He was on the field for the coin toss, in fact, as the Clemson honorary captain. Kevin Butler, the legendary kicker for Georgia,
number seven
was
the
captain.
Team is changing his number to 14, 7-14.
For the Bulldogs, 40 years after he kicked a last-second field goal to beat Clemson from 60 yards away. Brett Thorson is the punter. And a beauty. It'll be downed inside the five by Arian Smith. Each team has had it once. No score. You're watching ESPN College Football on ABC, presented by Tums Gummy by five. Wins in a row. Flag thrown on first down from the Clemson five. Phil Moffa, the ball carrier. And Dabo Swinney said he was really proud of that. Nine wins is a disappointment at Clemson. But he said back then, when you're 4-4, you can show what you're made of. And he thought they did by winning those last five games.
Holding offense on the 53. That penalty's declined. Defense will take the result for the play. Second down.
Ryan Linthicum is the center for the veteran offensive line.
He has some big shoes to fill. The center from last year, Putnam, was one of the better centers in the ACC. And Linthicum's been around the program for quite a while, a guy that has great understanding of this offense, a good leader within that room, but somewhat inexperienced compared to some of the rest of his cohorts on the O-line.
Kirby Smart elected to take the play in a 2-yard gain. Second and 8. Moffa outside. Powerful running. And he might have the first down. Dragged down by Raylan Wilson.
We did not often see Phil Moffa running outside the tackles last year. Really makes his hay keeping his shoulders square even with the line of scrimmage. He's a one cut running back, but he's so tough to bring down once he gets a full head of steam. And that time they get him on the edge and he finds some momentum.
Well, they won their last five, as we just chronicled. Over the last six games, he averaged more than 20 touches per game. They just went to the ground game and did a lot of this on third and inches. A first down for Moffa, grad student from Loganville, Georgia. And there are the numbers. First seven games, he averaged just 8 yards per carry. Splitting time with Will Shipley, who's now in the NFL as a fourth round draft pick of Philadelphia. Shipley hurt. Moffa got a lot more of the ball carrying and took advantage of it, including 36 carries, a school record, for 186 yards in that win against Notre Dame that started the winning streak. Here he comes again to the outside. And he's stopped after a short gain by C.J. Allen, the sophomore linebacker.
That's twice now. Moffa's been pitched to the outside, getting outside the tackles. This has been a bit of a vulnerability for Georgia's defense last season. They're still good against the run, but at one point between 19 and 22, those seasons, they averaged giving up just 76 rushing yards a game. Last year was 113 rushing yards a game. So they've not been as good on the edges of the defense last season, trying to improve it this year.
After a gain of 3, second and 7. Kay Klubnik will throw it away. Looking everywhere but couldn't find anybody open. And I think they'd actually like to see more of that,
right,
rather than force it in someplace and commit a turnover, take a sack. Adam Randall being chastised by Coach Sweeney. Warren Brinson is the injured Georgia Bulldog, starting defensive lineman for Kirby Smart. The crew delighted to be back together for the start of another college football season. A great way to get it going in the Aflac kickoff game. Clemson and Georgia memorably opened the season head to head in 2021. In a rock fight in Charlotte, a 10-3 Georgia win on their way to a national championship. Third down and 7. Warren Brinson has come off the field. Diving catch made and a good one, but short of the first down. Antonio Williams with Dalen Everett draped all over him. It's fourth down. The offense is on the field, and now it's not. Dabo Swinney hesitated for a moment, but is not going to go for a fourth and one. 9 minutes in from his own 26-yard line.
And a good decision. Not a team that really went for it a lot last year. Just 24% of their fourth down decisions did they go. That was about 64th. So smart here, conservative play. Defense has played well so far.
So Aiden Swanson to punt again. Averaged 43.7 last year, fifth best in a season in Georgia history. And that one is a fair catch by Anthony Evans. 42-yard punt. Week one continues. What a lineup throughout this packed Labor Day weekend on ABC and ESPN. 3:30 today on ABC. Miami and Florida. Tonight, 7:30 on ABC. Notre Dame against Texas A&M. Sunday, USC and LSU. From the Modelo Vegas kickoff classic and Monday night, Boston College is at Florida State in the Capital One Labor Day kickoff. It's the Noles that have bounced back after their loss in Dublin last weekend to Georgia Tech. Boston College beginning a new era under a great coach in Bill O'Brien. 5.5 minutes to go here in the first quarter. Branson Robinson, the ball carrier, missed all of last season with an ACL injury. R.J. Mickens made the stop.
So far, Clemson very aggressive in the back end defensively. Mickens that time, when the ball was snapped, he was 6, 7, 8, 9 yards downfield, coming up in run support immediately. So if they continue to see those safeties getting down near the box, you can anticipate a play action throw it over their head from Carson Beck and Mike Bubba, the OC.
Robinson remains the running back. The pass out wide, and another good open field tackle by a Clemson defender. Dominic Lovett taken down by R.J. Mickens, graduate student, playing in his 48th career game. That's most of any player on this Clemson team.
A nice tackle in the open field. And that's one thing you'll notice about Clemson. At the second and third level, they are great tackling in space. That time they do, instead of allowing a catch and run against a shifty wide receiver.
Neither team can get much going on offense so far. Beck has Cash Jones on his left hip. They had a three receiver bunch to the right and another good tackle to prevent a first down. Dylan Bell stopped by TJ Parker. With Jaden Lucas, pardon me.
And you're going to see number three, TJ Parker, loop around inside. Really well timed with the stunt. He gets a free run right at Carson Beck and delivers a big shot to force the ball out of Beck's hands quickly and allow his defender to drag the receiver down before the line to gain.
Brett Thorson to punt. Antonio Williams back. There was not a single punt returned against Georgia last year. Thorson punted 32 times. And the Tigers have not returned either of his two boots today. A 44-yard punt. And Athens even closer. Play fake by Cade Klubnik. They have 23 yards of offense so far. Deep throw and a catch. A beautiful catch by Antonio Williams on a beautifully thrown ball by Cade Klubnik.
What a throw by Cade Klubnik. A good win against the top cover corner of Georgia, Dalen Everett. If I'm Clemson, I'm hustling so they don't take a look at it.
36-yard gain to the 49-yard line.
Win on the field is a completed catch for the first down. That play is under further review.
By Remus Kozica in the replay booth, along with Patrick McEnany.
Just perfect ball placement over the top by Cade Klubnik. As Williams is going to the ground,
I think that's a catch.
Looks like he has control. Is that foot down? As soon as he gains control, looks like that right foot down, that right knee is down. And remember, it's called a completion on the field. Has to be indisputable video evidence beyond all doubt to overturn. Did the nose of the football hit as he's going to the ground? Let's take a look here. And it looks like it does, but does he have control? It's really difficult to tell.
Well, let's bring in our rules expert. We're delighted. Well, we'll let Michael Roach have his say.
After further review, the ruling on the field stands. The first half of the
I think we all agree. Matt, what say you, my friend?
I agree also. What the replay official looks like on a, looks for in a play like this is, did the ball separate from the receiver's hand? In this case, I don't think it did. Yes, it hit the ground, but I think he still had control. I think it's a good stance.
And remember, if they had indisputable video evidence to confirm, they would say the play was confirmed. So just not enough to overturn there, and a heck of a throw and catch.
36-yard play. Williams' injury played last year, got in only 5 games. Dabo Swinney says we are better around Klubnik this year, in part because Williams is back. Jay Haynes in at running back. Freshman from Alabama. Limited playing time last year.
Reference it, Sean. I mean, Klubnik certainly had his struggles last year. There was a learning curve as Jay Haynes comes off a lot of speed. He'll be there to kind of be their speed big play back. But you can't play quarterback by yourself. And I think the receivers being in and out of the lineup was really challenging for the young man last year. Now with a really healthy group, they should be solid.
Phil Maffa back in at running back. Play fake to him. And in the flat, it's Brindingstool, the tight end, driven back immediately by Smile Munden. Veteran senior linebacker, their leading tackler 2 years ago and second on the team last year behind Tyke Smith. They have 7 returning starters on defense, but they did lose 3 secondary members to the NFL draft. Terrific players in Javon Bullard, Kamari Lassiter, and Tyke Smith. Third down and 9. Clemson's 1 for 3 on third down. Play fake. Klubnik on target. Antonio Williams has a first down. There is a flag down far side of the field along the line of scrimmage. And they're bringing the ball back.
Illegal formation on the offense. More than 4 players in the backfield.
Dabo Swinney furious, and that's another big time avoidable mental mistake up at the top of the screen. It doesn't look like he's on the line of scrimmage. See, Brindingstool's off, Stellato in the slot off, but doesn't look like Adam Randall ever got all the way up the line, which is a massive mistake after the conversion.
Wipes out a first down. Now they're facing 3rd and 14. Little bubble screen, and Antonio Williams had no chance. Raylan Wilson there. You'll see a lot of action at linebacker, sophomore from Tallahassee.
Those are the mistakes there on third down after a conversion that just drive you crazy as a coach in week 1. They're understandable. You can't have them in week 5, 6, and 7. They're far more likely to happen early in the year, but when your first opponent is Georgia, you just can't make mistakes like that because the opportunities are too few and far between.
Aiden Swanson to punt again. He's been around so long, he got his degree in marketing December of 2022. Hits at the 10 and goes into the end zone. 52-yard punt, but not what they were hoping for. Philip Florenzo, the long snapper.
Multiple running backs, Quinshon Judkins, get Will Howard from Kansas State, Caleb Downs, a safety from Alabama. They are loaded.
Final seconds of the opening quarter, and it is reminiscent of that 2021 opener between these two. Beck's now 6 out of 7, where they've all been short gainers. Some run after the catch there for a 9-yard gain for Branson Robinson. And he had some spirited conversation, actually more of a monologue from Coach Sweeney. Nate Frazier in at running back, highly touted freshman. His first carry as a collegian for 3 yards. He's out of Compton, California, Southern California powerhouse modern day. And he can move for a big guy at 210.
Yeah, he can fly. 10-5 in the 100, and you talk to those around the program when you're already drawing some comparisons to DeAndre Swift. I'd say your career's off to a pretty good start. very versatile piece that should have a big impact this season.
Again, Trevor Etienne not playing today after an offseason arrest. Carson Beck on first down out to the perimeter, and quickly closing was Jaden Lucas on Dylan Bell. Here's Molly.
Well, Sean, when we asked Kirby Smart if this would be a one game suspension for Trevor Etienne, he said not necessarily. So the length of this suspension is still unclear. But one thing is clear. This team believes in Etienne. I'm told he took accountability with his teammates. Coaches say he is the unquestionable leader, the number one back for the Bulldogs. And on the sidelines, he's been very active coaching up their young running backs and even speaking with their offensive line during this game.
And the coaches did tell us he will be their number one running back when he becomes active. Dominic Lovett down the sideline and shoved out of bounds by Wade Woodhaz at the 48 of Clemson, a 15-yard pickup to Lovett.
And just a great job. Clemson has been selling out against the run, so just go with a bit of an extended handoff. It's no different really than a triple option. You see guys disappear inside. Hey, boom, that's your pitch man right out in front. Instead, it's a forward pass. Love it. With plenty of speed out in the open space, picks up a nice game.
It's the longest play for Georgia, the 15-yard game. Beck's 8 out of 9 passing, but for just 44 yards. Here's Cash Jones. Swung down, but close to another first down. He's been primarily a special teams player for Kirby Smart, but Kirby told us last night we've taken him off most of the special teams because he's going to be a valuable running back.
Just a really good football player. Walked on. He's going to New Mexico State. Kirby and Del McGee convinced him to walk on here, and he's been a nice surprise. But here on 2nd and 1, if I'm like Bobo, I'm thinking shot play. Likely have 3rd down and 1 in the bag. Take a shot, see if you can't throw it over the aggressive secondary's head.
Clemson has called a timeout for the first time today. The Tiger defense on its heels. No score. We're early in the second quarter in Atlanta.
Is there anything you'd like to add?
7:30 tonight. Download the ESPN app or go to ESPNplus.com.
For the shot play here, if you're the Clemson defense, this will be where I'd try to take one downfield.
2nd and 1. Catch made by Colby Young, the transfer from Miami. He was a key weapon last year for the Hurricanes, and they expect him to be a factor here. He's been battling a little bit of a hamstring injury in camp.
Just a good decision by Carson Beck. You see soft coverage by Avion Terrell. Take it underneath your big body wide receiver.
For a gain of 8. They are in field goal range now for Peyton Woodring. Last time Georgia didn't score in the first quarter of a season opener was 2021 in that game against Clemson, the 10-3 Georgia win. The only touchdown of the game on defense. Wade Woodhaz took down Branson Robinson.
Woodhaz just continues to be a guy that Dabo Swinney inserts into the conversation. Yes, the other day talking to Dabo, he's asking him about Barrett Carter. He goes, I'm telling y'all sleeping on Woodhaz now. So
he's a pro, said Dabo. He's going to be a pro.
He's really a good player, and while he's been overshadowed, he makes plays. So involving himself early against a pretty good running attack that Georgia has at their disposal.
Team is primarily a safety, now the middle linebacker. Ben Jurasik looked like he flinched.
Well, Scott, on the offense, number 84, 5-yard penalty, 2nd down.
Kirby Smart high on Jurasik, who's a transfer from Stanford, where he had 108 catches over the last 3 years.
Highly productive player. He's been exactly what they expected to be there, though, jumping off sides after the quick shift by Clemson's defensive line. Using a little Georgia's medicine against him. Georgia does that all the time and gets people to jump off sides. This time Clemson uses it and puts Georgia behind the sticks.
Jurasik, Oscar Delp, Lawson Lucky will be the tight end group. Trying to fill the void with the departure of the great Brock Bowers. On target, it's Dylan Bell breaking one tackle. He has a first down inside the 15-yard line. Kylan Griffin prevented a touchdown. It's good for 23.
And this is well covered by Terrell, but the timing that Carson Beck releases this ball with is impossible to defend. That ball's out of his hand before Bell makes his in-breaking cut, And he's so strong after the catch, Bell. They moved him to running back last year because he's so good with the ball in his hands, and that time showing it off and getting him inside the red zone.
Branson Robinson, the running back now, and first and 10 from the 14. Fake to Robinson, and the slant is too high. Looking for Colby Young with Avion Terrell, the sophomore in coverage. He's a little shorter than coaches would typically like. Terrell's 5'11", but Glenn Schumann, Wes Goodwin, the defense coordinator, was telling us he has tremendous ball skills.
Very, very scrappy, and he got in there a little bit early. You see that left arm grabbing Colby Young as he tried to go up and get that ball high in the air, and might have gotten away with one there if you're Clemson.
Beck had completed 8 in a row. They're inside the 10-yard line now. That's Lawson Lucky, part of that tight end group. And Terrell made the tackle. 6-yard gain. Third down, 5 minutes gone by, second quarter. Georgia was best in the country on third down on both sides of the ball last year by percentage. 55% on offense. Clemson really struggled with red zone defense. Dabo Swinney said that's an area that needs to be much better this year. They're showing blitz. Beck in trouble and sacked. Peter Woods, the sophomore from Alabama, the Birmingham area, freshman All-American last season.
And they get some twists up here, and you'll see Woods just fill in as there's some disruption caused up front. Beck doesn't like anything initially. Woods slides up inside, working against Monroe Freeling, the sophomore, and drags Beck down to force the field goal. Excellent and relentless pursuit there by Woods.
Here's Peyton Woodring, the sophomore, but a terrific freshman year. Made 21 out of 25. This is a 30-yard attempt. Carson Beck is the holder. You don't often these days see the starting quarterback doing the holding, but he continues to do that this year. Separated by about 75 miles. They recruit a lot of the same players. Clemson has 23 players, including Phil Maffa, who's back deep for the kickoff. We're from the state of Georgia. And it's been a great rivalry. Back in the 20s and 30s, they were in the same conference, in the Southern Conference. Woodring's kickoff is a touchback. Time for the Aflac trivia question in the Aflac kickoff classic.
Aflac.
Okay. Wasn't sure if the duck was appearing again this year. It's our first game. We're still getting back into the flow. We want to know, and don't blurt it out because I know you know the answer. The three active FBS head coaches to have won an FBS national championship. What gives you know you're an academic All-American at Alabama, and you do your studying.
I'm mailed in the prep this week. I have no idea the answer to that question.
You did play a lot of golf. But that's okay. So Clemson, hampered by a couple of key offensive penalties, still scoreless. The toss to Maffa, and that Georgia defense ready for him after a 2-yard gain. He's down. Well, it is amazing, right, that there are only three active coaches who have won the national championship at this level. Of course, Nick Saban now doing a great job with us on game day. Jimbo Fisher is not coaching after leaving Texas A&M. I think Scott Johnson, our director, is trying to help the people who may be
just a little time,
relatively new to college football. A couple of shots of coaches here. The fake to Maffa, and then they throw it to him, and there's an example of a decision that I think the coaches for Clemson wish was different from Klubnik. All right, you want to blurt out the answer now?
To start a season, fewest national championship winning head coaches active to start a season since 1942.
You are correct, sir. Way to, you know,
next
add
level.
On to it, enhance it, move the conversation forward. You were paying attention at our seminar in Bristol. 3-0 Georgia. We're midway through the second quarter. After a 5-yard loss, Clemson with third down and 12. Klubnik on target, and Williams is banged out of bounds, short of the first down by about a yard. And Dabo Swinney, hands on hips, looking at the down marker and trying to decide if this is the time. And he tells Garrett Riley to call a play. They got 12, they need 13. Will they really snap it and go for it on fourth down and one? Down 3-0, they're at their own 34-yard line.
Certainly go with a hard count here, see if you can't get Georgia to jump off sides.
They've rushed for only 16 yards. Will they try to draw him offside, or will they really snap it? They turn and call a timeout. Dabo Swinney hollering at Klubnik. And one of the things that is new this year to college football is the coach-to-player communication in the headset. And Garrett Riley has the ability to talk to Cade Klubnik. So you would think, you know, Dabo's upset, but you would think they told Klubnik what he needed to know, what they wanted him to do in that situation.
Now, I think it took him a little while to decide, all right, hey, let's at least try it. I think they tried to get their hard count operation to get out there and see if you can't get Georgia jump off sides. It worked in success a little earlier when Mykel Williams jumped into the neutral zone. So they tried it, but they just didn't give it enough of a sell. They didn't give it enough time at the line of scrimmage to really make Georgia think about it.
Swanson punts. It takes a bad bounce for Clemson. Just 70 yards of total offense for the Tigers. And on the fourth punt of the day from Aiden Swanson, perhaps leg weary, 34-yard punt. Well, we mentioned it earlier. This is the 40th anniversary, one of the great games in the history of this rivalry. Tell you more about it after this snap from the 32-yard line. Carson Beck going to go under center with Branson Robinson, the lone running back. And it's Lawson Lucky. Out of bounds inside the 40. They'll mark it at the 37. A 32-yard pickup for Georgia, and they run quickly to the ball. Six minutes to go in the half. 3-0 Georgia. Robinson in trouble. And stopped behind the line. The initial contact by Peter Woods, who also finished him off. They're going to mark it at the 42 for a loss of 5. Clemson is out of timeouts. Georgia has all 3.
Great play there by Peter Woods. Played defensive tackle pretty much all of last year. Now sliding to the outside. And you wonder, can a guy at 315, 320 pounds play on the edge? Well, he did so right there with great quickness. So he's a handful in the run game, but he's showing some twitch in the pass game as well.
Nate Frazier, the true freshman in his first game, in at running back for the Dogs. He goes out into the flat, back down the middle, and off the arm of his intended receiver, Dominic Lovett, who was open, but they could not make the connection with Avion Terrell in coverage.
Just a little off the mark, too. If this ball is thrown in front of Dominic Lovett, in man coverage, he's already got a couple steps on Avion Terrell. He might turn the corner and take it to the house. So a rare misfire there from the future first round pick Carson Beck.
Was usually so accurate. 72.4% is completion percentage last year, the school record. They're 1-4 on third down. They're not in field goal range. Here's Cash Jones, tripped up shy of the 35. RJ Mickens the tackle. We asked Kirby Smart yesterday what would be the extent of Woodring's range. He said the 35-yard line. This is the 37, but they are going to apparently try a long one. It would be a career long.
Number 54 stands as number 85. 54 to 85.
It'll be a 55 yarder. His long last year was 48. He missed his only try last season from beyond 50. Beck is the holder. And that one is good. Kirby might want to rethink the 35-yard line based on that one. That was good with plenty of room to spare. Perfect snap, perfect hold, and it flirted with that left upright the whole way and just ever so slightly, like your drive does inside the left edge of the fairway, it cuts right back to the middle. And it squeaks inside for a really nice kick there from Woodring. Well, they've had a lot of terrific kickers in Athens over the years, including Kevin Butler. Let's flash back to 1984 and the voice of the legendary Larry Munson.
We're holding it on our own 49 and a half. Going to try to kick it 60 yards, plus a foot and a half. And Butler kicked a long one, a long one. Oh, my God! Oh, my God! The stadium is worse than bonkers.
Larry described it when Kevin Butler first came on the field, and there is Kevin before the game with his family, his wife Kathy, his mom Sharon. Larry said it's from 100,000 miles away. It's a 60 yard. Think of that, 40 years ago. Kevin Butler made it. It's still the longest field goal in Georgia history, and until last year, it was the longest in SEC history. He became a legend that day. Kevin tells the story. On Monday, he went to class. He got a standing ovation when he walked in, and his mom, Sharon, said, "Were they cheering because you made the kick or because you actually went to class?"
I think he would have been allowed one absence there on that Monday. But Kevin and his son Drew, getting to know him through you. I mean,
such a great family.
Just a phenomenal family, and one that is still held in just such high regard amongst the Georgia faithful.
So he's a legend, part of their broadcast team now. Kevin, the honorary captain today. Their son Drew, great punter at Georgia, won the Ray Guy Award and kicked in the National Football League. As Kevin went on to a long NFL career for many years, was the all-time leading scorer in Chicago Bears history. He was the first place kicker inducted into the College Football Hall of Fame. Mafah powers ahead. They've been trying to get him going. Prior to that, it was 5 carries for 17 yards. That one is 7 yards and is longest of the game.
And this is what Clemson's going to have to do if they're going to get into the playoff. They're going to win and contend for national championships. They have to be able to run the football. There's an experienced offensive line, new offensive line coach Matt Luke. They expect this group to be more physical than they've been in the past. And so far, they just haven't been able to get enough push against a really stout Georgia front. And Matt Luke's going to have to work on it at halftime.
Klubnik throwing it deep, looking for Cole Turner. Didn't see the ball coming. And K.J. Bolden, the true freshman, playing more than anticipated with the absence of Jonel Aguero, almost had a chance for his first career interception.
Man, Cole Turner had a step. I see exactly what Kate Klubnik was looking at. I mean, Cole Turner's behind the defender, Julian Humphrey, and it got a chance to hold the red line and throw it 50, 60 yards downfield for a potential touchdown, but Turner gave up on it and never really tracked the football.
Turner played in only 2 games last year. He's the fastest player on the offense. Another reason why they think they'll be better on offense. They haven't been better today. Randall's the target, and it's broken up by Julian Humphrey. Flag down at the end of the play. Humphrey's a new starter this year, redshirt sophomore from Webster, Texas.
After further discussion, there is no foul for defensive pass interference on the play. An incomplete pass and the fourth down.
And I like this no call, actually, because you see the left hand of Adam Randall actually trying to push off as well, but that's a bad throw there by Cade Klubnik. Randall's got 2-3 yards of separation. You have to throw that ball to the outside. anything underthrown is going to allow the defender to recover. So you got to get that ball up and down. You got to keep him vertical. And big play was wiped out there.
Dabo Swinney complaining to the side judge, Milton Britton, who had absolutely nothing to do with it. Fourth down and three. And here comes the fifth punt.
That's part of the job, though, of those officials on the sideline. They take an earful for a lot of things they had absolutely nothing to do with.
I think that was the right call, though. I mean, because it looked like you could have called OPI, and I think you could have called DPI, so you might as well just make it a no call.
Call a no PI. Matt Austin, by the way, at his palatial estate, is nodding his head in agreement with you. Swanson again caught on the run by Anthony Evans, and he's taken down immediately. That's the snapper again, Philip Florenzo. Here's Molly.
Sean, on that last Georgia possession, Carson Beck had an incompletion intended for Dom Lovett. On the sideline, Lovett came to him, said, "What can I do differently to help you?" And Beck took accountability, said, "That was all me. I need to calm down." It's rare that you hear Carson Beck say something like that. And he told us, without the safety blankets of Brock Bowers and Ladd McConkey, Lovett is the guy that he trusts the most because of interactions like that. They're always collaborating together to get better, guys.
Holding themselves to a high standard as usual, because that was one of only three incompletion, but it was a big miss. 3:13 to go in the half. All three timeouts left for the Dogs. Here's Nate Frazier for a pickup of four.
So far, Clemson's done a pretty good job against the run, giving up just 1.7 yards per carry here in the first.
Nearly two quarters. In his third year as the defensive coordinator.
Been very aggressive, though, in the back end. And have to continue to keep tight coverage. And, man, if they're going to contribute those safeties to the run game.
There will be a two-minute timeout. That's new in college football this year. Nice run for first down by the freshman, Frazier. They're going to mark it at the 42.
A couple pullers on the backside here. When you look at Frazier right behind him, just cuts. Big number eight, Trey Williams, couldn't find the running back. He cuts right behind him for a nice gain.
Pretty nifty vision. There's a flag down for an offside, probably a free play, and Beck let it fly in the direction of Arian Smith, a hard man to overthrow, but he did. And Clemson was offside.
Offside. Defense from the 55 in the neutral zone at the snap. Five-yard penalty, the first down. That's a two-minute timeout.
Peyton Page offside. And no question about it. Pitcher's duel here in Atlanta. 6-0 Dogs. 2 minutes to go. You're watching the Aflac kickoff game, first half.
Thanks to this waterfront hotel on Booking.com, even Yankees fans are loving Boston.
Oh, no, we're keeping
All right, gentlemen, neither team has run the ball. Each team with 23 yards rushing. Carson Beck's been the much more productive quarterback. He's thrown for 126 to 54 for Klubnik. He's running, throws, and a man wide open on a broken play. Dylan Bell, there is a flag down. There are two flags down. Scrimmage and a third on the near side of the field. Was a 37-yard play, but they're bringing it back.
Pass interference, offense number 11, 15-yard penalty, first down.
Arian Smith. So both teams with some key penalties on offense by wide receivers.
And Arian Smith, kind of in no man's land, tries to block, probably thinks for a second that Carson Beck's going to take off. So he engages and starts to block before the ball is released. And that's going to be offensive pass interference. That's a great job by the official. There was also the right tackle, Xavier Truss, was 4 or 5 yards downfield. That was a chaotic play where Carson Beck decided to pull it on an RPO run play, and it just resulted in chaos for the Bulldogs.
So they're back at their own 32 with a minute 48 left in the half. Georgia leading 6-0 on a couple of Peyton Woodring field goals from 30 and from 55, a career long. Nate Frazier, the running back again. Stopped at the 37, perhaps the 38, 5 yards for Frazier. And he's their leading ball carrier in this game with 20 yards on 4 carries.
Normally you'd think Georgia would maybe try to get into a 2-minute offense, but after that offensive pass interference gets him way behind the sticks, probably just content to take it to the half instead of making an unnecessary mistake.
And Clemson cannot stop it, even if the Tigers want to. Ticking down near a minute to go in the half. Carson Beck flushed. Flag thrown as he throws a wobbler that's incomplete. It hit Lovett, but he couldn't hang on. R.J. Mickens was there. The referee, Mike Roach, threw the flag well behind the line of scrimmage. I can read the lips of my fellow New Englander. It's a holding call.
Holding. Offense number 73. The penalties decline. Defense will take the result of the play. Third down.
Xavier Truss, one of the 4 starters, back on the offensive line from last year.
And it's so difficult on the tackles. You're engaged with a great edge rusher in T.J. Parker. Your quarterback leaves the pocket. And you just have that hand that holds on just a little bit too long to the outside. Nearly a big play there because that ball was almost intercepted too. Carson Beck throwing it back across his body. Not wise there by the veteran.
4 penalties for 35 yards for Georgia, all of them on the offense. Branson Robinson. Now will Georgia try to run another play? Well, they'll have to punt. Clocks are about 9 seconds apart.
If you could get it to 5 or 6 seconds, you could do a play called Rambo air ball, where you drop the quarterback back and throw it as high as you can to let the clock expire. But now the punt unit's going to have to come on. If you're Clemson, all out, send the house and see if you can't block one and maybe take it back to the house yourself.
You wonder, is there ever going to be an offensive touchdown when these two teams play? Last time in 2021 in the opener, it was a 10-3 Georgia win on a Chris Smith pick six.
It'll be 30-second timeout. Please just set the game clock to 11 seconds.
10-3 Georgia win. So 11 seconds to go. We begin this season with heavy hearts on our crew. Our great friend Rogers Redding passed away back in April at the age of 81. Longtime national coordinator of officials, a leading voice in rules interpretation on a field, official for more than 3 decades and 3 national championship games. Just a wonderful guy, survived by his wife Shirley, 4 children, 10 grandchildren. And our condolences to the Redding family and to Rogers' many friends. Big help to us over the years, as is Steve Shaw now leading the national officiating group. So Thorson, who jokes about his lack of usage, a little busier than usual today, and that one bounds into the end zone. With 1 second left in the half, let's bring in Matt Austin.
Yeah, Sean, thanks. I just want to say, found a personal note about Rogers Redding. He was a mentor to me, a great official, great supervisor for the SEC, worked for him, really allowed my career to take off, and I don't think I'd be sitting in this seat today without the influence that he had over my career. He also was the secretary rules editor of the rule book. So basically, he wrote the rules for NCAA football for several years and did a fantastic job. Mm-hmm. So it's a big loss for officiating.
Thank you, Matt. So Klubnik will take a knee. Despite only 77 yards of offense, Clemson very much in the game. George will get the ball first. Anthony Evans is back deep for the kickoff. Robert Gunn kicks off for the first time this season. And it's a touchback. He has a cannon for a leg. Time now for Built for Success, presented by Ram Trucks.
A little bit like Clemson. I think it's at this point, Clemson selling out against the run. Carson Beck, one of the best quarterbacks in the country. He was pretty good off play action early. The protection here was beautiful. He finds Lawson Lucky on a really nice route by Lucky. And then little RPO. Doesn't like the handoff, sees the collapse. Out to the flat goes Dominic Lovett. I think they're going to have to continue to lean into their play action passing game, because Clemson, like Georgia, is really selling out against the run and trying to make Georgia one dimensional.
Beck spread it around. He was 15 out of 19, completing passes to seven different receivers. Just 126 yards on those 15 completions. Ordinarily, he's a deep down the field thrower. Arian Smith got it to him on the first play of the game from scrimmage, their first offensive play, and they give it to him on the first play of the second half for a 7-yard run.
I think that's consecutive halves, and with the first play went to Arian Smith. And Mike Bobo, true to what he said yesterday when we visited with him, we have to get him going. He's a guy that can become at times disengaged, but he might be our most dangerous weapon for the opposing defense. So getting him involved early, both in the first and second half, didn't work so well in the first. Maybe it works a little better here in the second.
Of course, Mike Bobo is using the communication right into the helmet of Carson Beck. There's a nice call. Well executed. Smith again. First down inside the Clemson 40. Jaden Lucas stopped it from being even longer, 33 yards.
And a play really similar that we just saw a second ago, where they dumped it in the flat to Dominic Lovett. This time, they get Arian Smith on the wheel, and you have Delp out in the flat. They take away the flat. Smith gets behind him. It's an easy pitch and catch and a nice gain for the Georgia Bulldogs.
Smith caught 8 balls all of last year. He has 3 already today. Long count by Beck. Going for the end zone. Incomplete. A lot of hand fighting, and they'll let it go without a flag. Dominic Lovett and R.J. Mickens.
Oh, man, that was a good job by R.J. Mickens. You see that left hand, though, grabbing the jersey. He looks inside and tries to make a play on the ball as the progressive pylon cam gives you a great look at the PBU. But, man, that was very close to being pass interference on Mickens. The official just didn't see the hand, and Kirby Smart letting the official hear about it.
And Mike Roach, the referee, went all the way over to the sideline to take an earful from Kirby Smart. Dylan Bell. Dylan Bell down the sideline and out of bounds near the 5. Well, they took advantage of the halftime. Did these offensive coaches for Georgia some terrific play calling by Mike Bobo.
And just using their speed at their advantage, trying to play on the perimeter. I think they thought originally, hey, we can probably go downhill against this Clemson team. They're not huge up front defensively. They found that that wasn't a very successful plan early on. Now trying to get those big guys up front for Clemson, running sideline to sideline with jet sweeps and some misdirection.
First and goal. They've gone 66 yards in just 4 plays. Nate Frazier stacked up after a 2-yard gain. 68 yards on this drive. They had 160 yards of offense total in the first half.
This part of the field last year, second down, low red zone, it was Brock Bowers' world. I mean, he owned this part of the field. Who's going to be that guy this year for the Georgia Bulldogs when they get field condenses? You don't have that big body outside. It's probably going to be Colby Young who's lined up to the top in one-on-one. Let's see if they throw a fade in his direction.
They do. And it is caught for a touchdown. He beat Jaden Lucas in coverage.
You could see it from a mile away. Lucas lined off and inside. That's absolute giveaway for the back shoulder fade. It's perfectly thrown by Carson Beck. He throws Young away from the defender. And it's an easy pitch and catch. A guy that really majored at Miami last year and making those contested catches in the end zone reels it in with ease. And Georgia thinking about going for two.
Young from Binghamton, New York, caught 5 touchdowns for the Miami Hurricanes last year. They're going for two. Go for Dose, brought to you by Dos Equis. Beck with a flag to stop the play.
False start. Offense number 6. 5-yard penalty. Replay the track.
Do you still go for two?
I wouldn't.
Nope. We're going to send the kicker on now, Peyton Woodring, who did not miss an extra point last year in his freshman year, 71 out of 71. 75 yards to open the half on 6 plays. Very impressive drive. A 7-yard touchdown reception by Colby Young, his first as a Georgia Bulldog. Beck threw 24 touchdown passes last year. Would have been more, but he didn't play a lot late in games. They had leads. They didn't play in the second half of their 63-3 win in the Orange Bowl over Florida State. And Woodring's kick is good. And finally, an offensive touchdown in the game edition there. Beer and gummies. There is a touchback off the foot of Woodring. Here's Molly.
Well, Sean, when we met with Clemson head coach Dabo Swinney, he lamented their issues converting in the red zone last season, and that's exactly what he harped on at halftime. He said they had 2 opportunities in the red area in the first half, and one was called back because of a penalty, so he's very frustrated with the composure of his team. He said, we're capable, we're good enough, we're in this game. We just have to stop shooting ourselves in the foot and play with more confidence, especially on first downs. Guys.
And it really feels like, too, Molly, they have to answer here. I mean, they've had mental mistakes for sure. That's to be expected in the first half of the first game, but they can't beat themselves, and they almost have to answer with points on the drive.
I think Dabo Swinney and Garrett Riley could use some Tums gummy bites right now. Their stomachs have to be churning. They had such high hopes for this offense, and they've only played a half, but 76 yards of total offense. They're still trying to get Phil Maffa going. Chris Riley brought over last year after he won the Broyles Award in 2022 for his work as the offensive coordinator at TCU. Brandon Streeter, whom he replaced, is now an offensive analyst at Georgia. Timeout.
You know this is happening.
Shall we?
Get the Disney bundle.
Download the ESPN app or go to ESPNplus.com/schedule to watch all the action. Roof closed here today with the temperature 90 degrees outside, and the feels like 96. We had some record high temperatures in Atlanta this week. Play fake by Klubnik. And they're ready for that quick pop to the wide receiver, Cole Turner. All they got was 1 yard. Glenn Schumann is the defensive coordinator with a new co-coordinator this year. Will Muschamp, who had been serving that role the last couple of years, has gone off the field to serve as an analyst so he can go watch his son Whit play at Vanderbilt, where he's a freshman quarterback. One out of 6 on third down. The average to go 8 yards. Hard to convert when you have that much distance. Klubnik! Schoolyard play, and it worked. Jake Brenningstuhl has the hard-earned first down for a 19-yard gain.
Klubnik finally found him, but it took him long enough. If you watch Brenningstuhl on the left side, he's on a shallow cross, and he's wide open, and he just keeps running. It's zone coverage. He's got to sit that down and make it easier on his quarterback, but he bails him out with an incredible one-handed catch. Just going up and reeling it in. Very, very impressive by the tight end, who became such a huge weapon for them last season. And to make things even sweeter for the Tiger offense, they're going to tack on an unsportsmanlike roughing the passer that has them knocking on the door of the red zone.
Just their second snap on the plus side of midfield in this game. Damon Wilson called for the roughing the passer. Mafah stopped at the 32-yard line for a pickup of four. He averaged 5.5 yards per carry last season, and almost 1,000 yards for the year, 965 yards, and that was dividing time with Will Shipley, ran for 875. They're a great duo. He's going to be the featured back all season long this year.
And I would think right here you're going to have a chance to hit number 22, Cole Turner, your fastest receiver at the bottom of the screen. You might have one-on-one coverage with him. Let's see if Clemson tries to take a shot right here.
Dalen Everett has the coverage at the bottom of your screen. Klubnik to the far side of the field. Nice move by Antonio Williams. Julian Humphrey got back in the play and made the tackle, but it's another Clemson first down at the 22.
And that's not an easy throw. I know it's only 5 or 6 yards downfield, but all the way from the right hash to the left, it's a tough throw.
Mafah inside the 20. And again, when we talked with Dabo Swinney, Greg, during the week, red zone, both ends of the field, both sides of the ball, a problem. Clemson on offense. And a lot of first downs last year, moved up and down the field, but in the red zone they were 118th in red zone scoring in the country. First trip to the red zone today. Nice fake by Klubnik. Brennan Stuhl's open. He lowered his head and came up a little bit short of the first down yardage. KJ Bolden in on another tackle, making a nice freshman debut.
Especially considering that Georgia seems to have figured something out offensively on the last drive. I would think four down territory for Garrett Riley, Kate Klubnik, and this Clemson offense.
By far the best drive for Clemson. Well, both offensive coaching staffs making some effective adjustments at the
previous
half.
Play is under further review for potential targeting.
While we were away, Mike Roach, the referee, announced after review, no targeting against KJ Bolden. That's huge. They're already a man short with Janelle Aguero, their usual starting star, not playing. Bolden playing more than expected. So Clemson on the move, third down and two, down 13 to nothing, almost midway through the third quarter. Mafah. First down, a powerful run, dragging Bulldogs with him to the 7-yard line. Four first downs on this drive. They had two the entire first half.
And a great job by the right guard and the center of this Clemson offensive line, Ryan Lithicum and Walker Parks. It's great to have Walker Parks back. Just engaged for a really long time against Christian Miller, and Mafah runs right inside of him with the third down conversion.
First and goal from the 7. Mafah got one. Raylan Wilson there for Georgia.
This is a part of the field last year too that was really problematic. They had a bunch of fumbles in this part of the field, two against Duke in the opener, one against UNC, one against Miami. They used to read that play. Let's see if they've opted to maybe take the read out of it because of all the miscues they had in this part of the field in 23.
Out of the gun with Mafah, the running back, a fake to the motion man, and Georgia not fooled. Mikel Williams was right there, and Klubnik slipped down as he tried to avoid him. It's a loss back to the 9.
And Colin Sadler in for the previously injured Marcus Tate, going against one of the best defensive linemen in the country. Just can't quite pin him out. It looked like Klubnik slipped a little bit too as he tried to cut to the inside, but man, that's a tough ask for a guy that's fresh off the bench a moment ago.
You think they would like to get it to Brenningstuhl, the big tight end. He's part of that 3-receiver bunch to the left. George is showing blitz. They bring it. Klubnik throws it for the corner. There's a flag down. It falls incomplete. intended for Antonio Williams with Dan Jackson running in coverage. Flag thrown by one of the officials behind the offense. There is an injured Georgia player. It's Mikel Williams, the standout junior.
Personal foul, legal block below the waist. Offense, number 7. The penalty is declined. It'll be fourth down.
And that block was on Mikel Williams.
You'll see Maffa working right across to Mikel Williams, who's going to slide inside. And he goes low below the waist. Mikel getting up now under his own power, and this has been an adjustment the last couple of years. If you're going to block below the waist, it has to be inside the tackle box. It has to be straight ahead. So to come at an angle is illegal, and that's what the official did there. So Maffa came across his body, came at an angle to the left leg of Mikel, and that's what resulted in the penalty.
So here's their new kicker, true freshman, Nolan Hooser, who kicked 66 field goals in high school in Cornelius, North Carolina. A little different kicking in front of 71,000 on national TV in the opener in the AFAC kickoff game, but he converts from 26 yards, and Clemson is on the board. They had a lot of field goal kicking problems last year, made just 62%. Of their field goals, which is extremely low, among the worst in the country. 6 yards, 12 plays, but a disappointing end having to settle for the field goal.
Yeah, and a big moral victory there for Georgia. Got gashed a couple times, had to endure the roughing the passer, and still to hold them to a field goal feels like a big win for the Dogs.
Speaking of Georgia Tech and Syracuse, great win for Georgia Tech, obviously, in Dublin against Florida State. And Syracuse about to begin the Fran Brown era, former Georgia assistant. The kickoff by Robert Gunn is a touchback. Here's Kevin.
Sean, AT&T is keeping fans connected as we take a look at our multi-view, which is showcasing a bunch of great events across our networks as we wrap up August. ESPN right now, we got Virginia Tech within 10 points of Vandy. Vandy trying to pull off the upset at home. Over on ESPN2, U.S. Open action continues. The men's top seed, Yannick Sinner, part of that third round action. ESPNU, Pitt just scored. They're up 34-21, and Tennessee continues to roll on the SEC network. Back to you, Sean, Greg, and Molly.
All right, Kevin, so great to have college football fully underway in what is known as week one. There was some action in week zero last weekend. Most of college football begins this weekend. Play fake by Beck, and all alone in the flat, Nate Frazier bust on defense for Clemson. And the play goes all the way to the 49-yard line where Kobe McLeod ran down Frazier after a gain of 24.
And most of this game has been number 0 Barrett Carter and Wade Woodaz at linebacker. Well, Kobe McLeod comes in to give Woodaz a little bit of a break, and he busts on the first snap. Does not find Frazier in man coverage out of the backfield, and it results in a huge play to start the drive for Georgia.
Beck 18 out of 23 for 189 and the touchdown. Faked it to Frazier, goes for the tight end Delp, and it was very well covered on the Clemson sideline by Khalil Barnes, the nickel, who was a freshman All-American last year. He's from Athens, Georgia, playing against his hometown university today in a game that means a lot to him.
Very disciplined play, too. Eyes in the back the entire way. Barnes has such great instincts. That's a tough ask to cover a guy. They're giving up 6-7 inches in length to, and a lot of weight as well, as Dylan Bell being helped off, one of the most versatile weapons on this offense. Not a good sight there.
5:41 to go, third quarter. Georgia up by 10. Frazier has it go off his hands. Forward pass, an incomplete pass. Interesting that without Trevor Etienne today serving the suspension, the primary running back has become Nate Frazier, a freshman in his first college game out of Compton, California. getting some encouragement from Etienne after the drop. Third down and 10. Georgia just 1 out of 6 on third down after leading the country on third down a year ago. Beck fires on target. London Humphreys, his first catch as a Georgia Bulldog. A transfer from Vanderbilt, 23 yards, and a Georgia first down.
And a great throw here by Carson Beck. Eyes vertical the whole way. You can see Khalil Barnes, number 7, over pursuing just a little bit. He throws it right behind him, and a terrific catch by Humphreys.
One of 11 they brought in out of the transfer portal. Beck pulls it down and runs for what looks to be a first down. It will be an 11-yard gain for Beck, his second double-figure run of this afternoon.
Really underrated part of his game. I mean, last year he had 182 yards rushing when you take out the sack, so he can hurt you there. He's not going to kill you with his legs, but he can certainly keep you honest.
Good athlete. He was a very highly recruited baseball player out of high school. In fact, he originally committed to the University of Florida to go play baseball and then change direction. First and 10, they're at the 18. Frazier breaks a tackle and gets knocked down on the second try by DeMonte Capehart. Barrett Carter, an unusual miss on the tackle. A preseason All-American, number 0 for Clemson, who plays all over the place on their defense, just as Malachi Starks does for Georgia.
Georgia continues to have a lot of success with some misdirection. That time, full flow out to the left. You would think at some point they get back to the misdirection where they've already found a bunch of big plays here in the second half.
We're told it's just cramps for Dylan Bell. That's good news. Even though the roof is closed, it is warm inside Mercedes-Benz Stadium. Nifty moves. Love it. Down to the goal line. R.J. Mickens. Stop the touchdown, and Georgia has found its groove on opening day.
And when you watch Lovett in Missouri a couple years ago, this is what he was. He's so good after the catch.
They come to the line quickly after the 13-yard gain. Frazier into the end zone. Frazier punched it in from 1 yard out. His first college touchdown in his Georgia debut. And back-to-back 75-yard drives here in the third quarter after they did not score a touchdown in the first half. Peyton Woodring for the extra point. A 20-3 lead for the Dogs, to the dismay of the Tiger faithful.
And just a great job washing down by the left side of the offensive line. And you got to give some love too to number 7, Lawson Lucky, who kicks out Wade Woodaz to allow the seam for Frazier to run right through it. Just an excellent, excellent drive by Georgia. Great calls there by Mike Bobo, the offensive coordinator.
Two possessions in the second half and two touchdown drives of 75 yards, so a total of 150 after they had 160 total in the first half. And they just continue to go all over the country and bring in 4- and 5-star recruits. Frazier's just another. And the number 1 rated recruiting class last year, according to ESPN.
Kirby referred to him as a little ball of energy. He knew he was going to be a good player, man. And it's not at all surprising to see him in his first game already in the end zone, becoming kind of the featured player in this game in the second half.
So Woodring kicks off. F- Phil Maffa, no chance to return that one. It's out of the back of the end zone. Here's Molly McGrath.
Well, Georgia star defensive player Mikel Williams had his left ankle wrapped. He was in visible discomfort when he jogged, and I can tell he's in pain. He was talking to teammates about that Maffa block, and that's what happened and hurt his left ankle. But I'm told he's going to try to play, but they'll monitor it closely, guys.
You just hate to see that, too. A guy that has always been impactful, but this was his first full fall camp where he was at 100% healthy. So they really anticipated him having a huge impact on the season in the first month and a half. But now, hopefully, that ankle doesn't linger throughout the year.
Here's Maffa. Knocking down would-be tacklers as he comes up just shy of the 35-yard line. A gain of 9. He's coming off a 4 rushing touchdown effort in their wild come-from-behind win in the Gator Bowl against Kentucky. 38-35. He scored the winning touchdown in that game. 17 seconds to go. It was 21-10 Kentucky going to the fourth quarter of that one. Maffa dropped for no gain by Jalen Walker, the hybrid linebacker.
He's a guy you're going to hear an awful lot of this year. They are so impressed with how much he's grown this offseason. He's become better off the ball playing traditional linebacker, but he's always been a force on the edge. So he's a name to remember throughout this season. Might have a huge impact for the Dogs on defense.
Again, so many NFL prospects all over this team, particularly on the defense. 42 players drafted out of Georgia in the last 4 years. Klubnik kept it, and he gets stopped short of the line of the game. Jalen Walker.
And just the right side, the defender, number 5, Raylan Wilson, completely blows it up. Cade Klubnik somehow rescues it, gives himself a chance, but that play had no shot from the beginning. It looked like Brenningstuhl and company were not really in position to try to knock guys off the point of attack.
Would you think about going for this?
I would, especially given how George has played offensively the last couple possessions.
You're down 3 scores. You're ticking down a minute to go in the third quarter. All of a sudden, your defense can't get stops. Swanson punts again. Short, nose up, spiral. Fair catch made by Anthony Evans. 6th punt, 35 yards. I'm going to pay attention to when these games are. These are tonight, Sean. Tonight, SEC College Football on ESPN Plus and SEC Network Plus. Eastern Kentucky against Mississippi State at 6. Furman against number 6 Ole Miss at 7, at 7:30 Alabama and A&M against Auburn. Auburn, by the way, trying to earn its 800th all-time win tonight. Ooh. And they would be the 13th program to get there. Clemson's 2 away from that number. 160 yards total first half, 150 on 2 touchdown drives here in the third quarter for Georgia. Beck 20 out of 27 for 225. And that's through the hands of Nate Frazier. We talked about the helmet and the coach to player communication, Greg, and talking to Mike Bobo and Kirby Smart last night, they said, we really don't need it. He said, Beck is so cerebral. Mike Bobo said he processes information better than any quarterback that I've ever coached. And we asked Carson Beck about it. He said, I basically just want them to give me the play. Give me the play and turn the microphone off.
Yes, please. Especially just give me the play if I make a mistake. Mm-hmm. I really don't want to hear about that immediately after the fact.
Mike Bobo said he would use it very sparingly. Maybe occasional reminder tacked on to a play about the down and distance, or hey, we might go for it on 4th down here. So you have 2 plays. Nate Frazier, the ball carrier. Interesting talking to Garrett Riley on the other side, too. He said, I think a lot of coaches will misuse it. You know, right. The temptation will be to give the quarterback too much information, and now you're overwhelming him and causing confusion and perhaps slowing the process down. Final half minute of the third quarter. Georgia in no hurry with now a 17-point lead. two out of seven on third down, the Dogs. The blitz from deep didn't get there. The pass is incomplete. Intended for Ben Jurasik, the Stanford transfer, with Jaden Lucas nearby.
I think what's been encouraging about this performance for Georgia, while it's far from finished, there's a lot of things that they can clean up, though. That in particular, I mean, if Jurasik just keeps running, it's an easy pitch and catch, and he might even have a chance to get first down out the back gate. So Kirby's got to be loving this tape. In control, playing well, but still a lot of very correctable, very fixable errors.
And Thorson, in the last 2 years, his single season punt totals have been the two lowest since 1948. Bombs one there with a well-rested leg. He has a great sense of humor on social media. When Carson Beck announced he was coming back, Thorson tweeted, "Ugh, now I'm going to get even less playing time." I think 56-yard punt. Yes, the funny guys from Australia.
That is good stuff. Yeah, the quarterbacks and the punters don't often get along, because if he's going on because we failed, it's not usually a super friendly relationship. So, you know, it's understandable.
But and when he does punt, it's never returned.
Ever.
He went all
ever.
Last year without allowing a punt return on his 32 punts. Part of that's he hits it high. The other part of it is they have Arian Smith and Dom Lovett as the gunners running down there. Great speed. Are there to pressure the receiver. Tyler Brown.
We've been able to knock a ball off of him, but we got to continue to do what we do and play the next moment.
All right, thank you, coach.
Thank you.
On target, Klubnik to Tyler Brown on the first play of the fourth quarter. They're going to try to pick up the tempo here. That was a point of emphasis throughout camp for Kirby Smart. Glenn Schumann trying to get more turnovers.
For as good as they've been on defense, I mean, since they took over in 2016, they forced just 150 takeaways. That's 52nd in college football. And ironically, Clemson's number one with 193.
They had 17 takeaways last year. That was just 69th in college football. But then again, they were fifth in scoring defense, and that's really what it's all about. On third down and short, Maffa has the first down. If you are Clemson here, would you consider picking up the tempo, getting up to the here they come?
Yeah,
they have Bryant Wesco Jr. on the field right at the middle of your screen at the bottom, number 12, one of the most highly recruited wide receivers coming out of high school, true freshman from Midlothian, Texas.
They're very excited about his future.
Zier Stackhouse, their a college football playoff quarterfinal with the expanded field of 12. Will be played here in Chick-fil-A Peach Bowl, and the national championship game will be here. Klubnik in trouble. Looked like he was down before he threw it away. Pressure from Jalen Walker, their leading sack man from a year ago, with five.
Klubnik just too slow to react as Walker was coming around the side. Let's see. Okay. Looked like the left knee was down before he released it, and there it is. Ball clearly still in the hand. Left knee down, and a good call by the official.
First Georgia sack. It goes to Walker, junior from Salisbury, North Carolina. They think he's going to have a huge season. Klubnik high throw through the hands of Cole Turner. The attendance here today, 78,827. Well past the listed capacity is the Aflac kickoff record. TJ Moore on the field now, the other, along with Wesco, highly touted incoming freshman wide receiver. Where's number one? He's to the top of the screen on third down and 22. Play clock down to two. Lots of confusion on the offense. They finally snap it, and Klubnik runs into the rush. Raylan Wilson there for Georgia. A loss of two.
just can't happen there. That first down sack that Cade Klubnik took, you just can't do it. And that's something he's worked hard on all of season, eliminating the negative plays. Look, you're rolling to your left. You have no chance. You know they're breathing fire coming at you. You got to get rid of the ball quicker. You just can't take that sack. So, obviously, complete drive killer, and Clemson's forced to punt again.
Just 7 first downs for the Tigers, 135 total yards of offense. Aiden Swanson, a good punt, sending Anthony Evans back inside the 35. Might be a tired punt coverage unit. The return comes up just shy of midfield. 54-yard punt, 9-yard return. Here's our Sonic drive-in recap.
It's been an excellent second half offensively for Georgia, starting with some misdirection. They start with a little fake inside. Get Delp out in the flat, and Arian Smith up the wheel, and you got it. A couple plays later, you find Colby Young in a one-on-one situation on the back shoulder. Big third down conversion right here. You clear it out with Lovett. You have a guy underneath. And then in comes Humphreys, the transfer from Vanderbilt, who's been quiet today. And he finds a nice conversion. Frazier pays it off a couple plays later. It's been a terrific and efficient second half from the Georgia offense.
Quick pass from Beck to Arian Smith, and he gets dropped after a 2-yard gain. Well, like Bobo said, they'd make an effort to get Smith involved, and they clearly have. He said they know when the other team sees number 11 on the field, they're concerned because everybody's well aware of his blazing speed.
Yeah, I mean, he's the scariest guy on their offense right now that Brock Bowers departed, because he can end the game at any point. I mean, he can run right past you. And there's absolutely nothing you can do about it unless you give him a ton of respect and a bunch of cushion.
Branson Robinson in at running back. They faked it to him. Beck on target. First down. Arian Smith again with Jaden Lucas in coverage for Clemson. An 11-yard gain.
And this is what scares you to death. I mean, you think he's going to run right past you. So you know you have to give it a ton of respect, like Jaden Lucas does. He's 12, 15 yards deep, and then boom, he slams on the brakes, comes right back down his stem, creating separation from the defender. It's perfectly thrown by Carson Beck with great time and anticipation, and it's really uncoverable when you have that kind of speed.
Working with the new center today is Beck after terrific career by Cedric Van Pran. Jaron Wilson is the only new starter. I thought it was interesting what Carson Beck said to us. He said, you know, last year I was the new starter. Cedric Van Pran was very experienced. He helped me a lot. He said, I realized this year with my experience, I might have to help our new center, Jared Wilson. And Wilson's acquitted himself nicely today.
Yeah, he really has. I mean, Kirby raved about his athleticism and the fact that he's always been a great player. The problem is he could really only play center at a high level, and he happened to have an All-American in front of him. So it's not like he hasn't played because he isn't good. He just had great players in front of him. Not that dissimilar to Carson Beck.
And Pran, drafted by Buffalo in the 5th round, last draft. Here's some pressure. Beck gets it off, and it's incomplete. Intended for Colby Young with Avion Terrell in coverage for Clemson. Carson Beck, I admire his honesty talking to Molly McGrath. You know, a lot of Heisman Trophy candidates. I'm not really thinking about that. He admitted it's one of his goals, one of his reasons for coming back. So how would you rate his performance today with an eye toward winning college football's biggest individual award?
I think it's been very, very solid. I mean, he's never going to have statistically eye-popping ridiculous numbers because he had such a great supporting cast, but he's been very solid today.
Stands in, gets it off. London Humphreys down the sideline and into the end zone. Well, he's only caught 2 today, but they've both been big. A 23-yarder earlier, and this is a 40-yard touchdown.
And Humphreys on the shallow cross uses the umpire as a little bit of a pick right there. He crosses face, and there's nobody out the back door. Humphreys, the transfer from Vanderbilt, unbelievable top-end speed. And once he gets into the open field, it's going to be really hard to track down. And big play again from Georgia, showcasing that athletic ability that they have a wide receiver.
Well, they don't go into the portal much because they recruit so well, but they did bring in 11 players. They support a team that was number one most of last year. Woodring's extra point is good. And Dabo Swinney's reluctance to work in the transfer portal will undoubtedly be another topic of conversation after this game, as his team all of a sudden outclassed by Georgia in the second half. Leading 27-3 with just under 10 minutes to go here in the Aflac kickoff game from Atlanta. Phil Moffa back for the Peyton Woodring kickoff. It's another touchback. Here's Kevin.
Sean, time now for Allstate check-in. Good one in Nashville over on ESPN. Virginia Tech down 17-0 at one point here. Both Kyron Drones, the Bayshal Tootin. Yeah.
Really good job of holding that ball and allowing the back to uncover to the last minute, Kev.
We're tied at 20 apiece early in the fourth quarter. Sean, back to you. Oh, before that, coming up in less than an hour here on ABC, we've got a great matchup in the Swamp. Cam Ward making his Miami University debut for the Canes, taking on the Gators.
All right, Kevin, thank you. We said something very interesting when Kevin threw it back to us for the first time. Hit the editing room floor. Cade Klubnik on target. First down to Tyler Brown. Here's Molly.
Well, Sean, Georgia D lineman Michael Williams is back in their locker room for further evaluation. Remember, he previously suffered a left ankle injury late in the third quarter. He was favoring that left leg when he walked back to the locker room. He's not on their sideline right now, I'm told. He's out for now.
All right, Molly, thank you. Klubnik lets it go deep, and it is intercepted by the All-American Malachi Starks. It's the first turnover of the game for either team. And it comes in the building where Starks made an impressive debut against Oregon 2 years ago.
That is absolutely ridiculous by Malachi Starks. I mean, he played it just like a wide receiver, and yet he's in coverage. Eyes back to the inside immediately. Stays in phase with the wide receiver. Times his jump perfectly and rolls and high points that ball before securing it en route to the ground. Just an absolutely ridiculous interception from the All-American.
He played a lot of last year with an injured shoulder. He had a torn labrum with which he played most of the year, had surgery in the offseason. Here's Nate Frazier. Nate Frazier. What a debut. All the way to the Clemson 38-yard line. 40 yards on the run.
Those that were comparing him to DeAndre Swift weren't kidding. I mean, he moves like him even. Just put a number 7 on that jersey. I feel like he's the exact same guy. Very shifty, but you see the acceleration too. I mean, guys, 10 500 meter dash guy, track guy that plays with great strength as well at 210 pounds. Just really tough to bring down. And my goodness, man, he's got a very bright future in Athens.
Maybe it isn't a foregone conclusion that when he's eligible, Trevor Etienne will be the starter at running back for Georgia. 66 yards rushing now on 9 carries for Frazier, the leading rusher in the game by far for either team.
Georgia takes its first time out of the game.
With 8:28 to go. 27-3. Dogs these seasons, both losses to Alabama. They have completely stifled Clemson all day long, and now the offense is picking it up. And Nate Frazier adding to his terrific college debut. Jaden Lucas made the tackle and came away limping a bit.
Just been such an impressive showing here in the second half from this Georgia offense. In the first half, really not a ton of rhythm. Average about 5.3 yards a play. Here in the second half, up to 10.6. Just crazy efficient. You see just the athleticism that they have at the skill positions, including running back. The true freshman already making an impact here.
Well, we talked about replacing the top two running backs. Dejon Edwards, Kendall Milton, both went to NFL training camps this year. I think I've seen enough of Frazier to believe he has more. And right on cue, announcer Jinx. He has more, you know, physical talent and skills.
Yeah.
More speed, you know, more the things you're looking. They were very good college players, don't get me wrong.
Great players.
But, you know, this guy looks like he has star potential.
No doubt. I mean, this guy has just got a different level of juice. I mean, you see him, and when he moves, he's moving faster and quicker than just about everybody else.
Too fast for his own good.
Yes,
there.
The turf monster did get him there. The old 20-yard line, it's always, that one's always a little higher than the rest. But you can tell he just has that big play potential that he just didn't have at running back last year.
And if he stayed on his feet, those numbers were going to be up significantly because he had some running room. Down goes Frazier. Took a long time to get that cliche in. Knocked himself out. There's Branson Robinson down to the 15. And now some tempers flaring. And we mentioned the 40 straight regular season wins, which is a formality now. This will also be 23 straight wins against non-conference opponents, including the postseason. They haven't lost to a non-conference foe since January 1st, 2019, to Texas in the Sugar Bowl. Cash Jones, the running back now. Carson Beck went under center. Jones bounces it outside, delivers a stiff arm, stumbled toward the pylon. Touchdown! Junior from Brock, Texas.
Progressive pylon cam. Does he stay in bounds?
Yes.
Looks like he does. Again, yes. Again, and colliding with the pylon right there.
Yeah. From that angle, it looked questionable, but from the down the line one that we saw, it was in bounds. There was a little green in between.
Yeah, that progressive pylon cam was awesome right there. That's a great look at it.
Do you want to say it again? Just let's give
Progressive
their entire
pylon.
I like that.
Progressive pylon.
We love our sponsors. Can't do enough for them.
The best.
Matter of fact, you might have a Modelo, and I'll have a Tums gummy bites after the game. Well, Cass Jones, as Kirby Smart said, he's too good a player to not play regularly on offense, so they've limited his work on special teams. He used to be on all of them. Well, a great part of this game involves outreach. Before he attended Clemson, Grayson Gentz was diagnosed with leukemia at 18 years old. While getting some treatment this summer, he had a chance to visit with Dabo Swinney, bring a smile to some of the faces of his fellow patients through the My Special Aflac Duck program. And Ethan Daniels, a freshman at Georgia, second from the left, was diagnosed with leukemia at age 11. After 3 years of treatment at the Aflac Cancer and Blood Disorders Center, he was declared cancer-free. How awesome is that? And earlier this month, he got to meet Kirby Smart, and together they visited a newly diagnosed patient. Gave him My Special Aflac Duck. A lot of great things being done in the name of charity associated to college football. Phil Maffa with the return. Really proud of the folks at Aflac, Chick-fil-A, who had their name on this game for a long time. Of course, they'll have their bowl game here later in the year.
Obviously, great contributors and supporters here of college football, and very, very grateful to how games like this, while everyone loves the home games, they're phenomenal, totally agree, but games like this in a neutral site do so much for the community. It's great for these teams to also have that opportunity as well to interact in a community that's not their own and maybe make an impact on a young life.
So it was a rough offseason for Dabo Swinney, answering a lot of questions about, at least to many around outside their program, their fan base, the slide of the program. Here's a quick pop to Antonio Williams. They won 9 last year for the 13th year in a row, but that was on the heels of 12 straight seasons of 10 plus wins. He made the point, you know, it's hard to get in the playoff. It was when it was 4. And after 6 years in a row in it, they weren't in it the last 3 years. Only eight different programs were in it the last 3 years. To his point, out of 134. But to his refusal to use the portal.
Right.
At least in any significant way. How do you feel about that?
Well, I think that when you are, it's not that he refuses to use it, it's just not a priority for the program, and they've missed on guys that they tried to go after. But I think when you basically shun the portal, you're going to have a lot of peaks, and you're going to have a couple valleys as well, because the portal can be used as kind of a band-aid to a possible vulnerability. If you have a problem or a hole at safety, a hole at left guard, or a hole at your wide receiver spot, then you go and get a guy out of the portal, and he just hasn't been willing to do that, instead of choosing to develop, and it's, I think, cost him a little bit the last 2 years.
No start since this portal started from a transfer out of the portal.
What I would say about it, though, too, is they played a lot of true freshmen last year. It's still a relatively young team, so there's a lot to play for, but when you're playing freshmen, you're going to have a lot of ups and downs, and that's what this team's experienced the last couple of years.
Klubnik hit as he throws it deep, and it's broken up. Nice play. Good recovery to the football by Ja'Cory Thomas, a backup defensive back, but coverage on Tyler Brown.
Opportunity downfield here. He had Tyler Brown for a minute, just couldn't quite get it out there in time, but he took a big shot as he was releasing the football by Damon Wilson. Klubnik's taking some big hits today. Just got to continue to speed up that process with some of his decisions that he's making.
Well, it's a tough way to open against the number one team in the country, a team that's great on defense year after year after year. And several will be draft picks again. That's up for grabs for Cole Turner, and all kinds of flags fly. We mentioned the recruiting for Georgia. Here's Ellis Robinson, the fourth, out of New Haven, Connecticut, in IMG Academy in Florida.
Defense, number one. 15-yard penalty automatic first half.
Five-star recruit, and many recruiting services had him rated the number one overall recruit at any position in the country, and he's at Georgia.
Yeah, and just a clear pass interference on the underthrown deep ball. He's going to have a very bright future. They're thrilled to have both him and KJ Bolden in the back end. Some young guys that they'll kind of factor in, continue to give more and more playing time as they get their confidence and comfort level within the defense up.
Penalty assessed from the line of scrimmage. They're at the 44-yard line. 4:20 to go. This recruiting class for Kirby Smart at 20 ESPN top 300 recruits. Klubnik throws it out to TJ Moore, a headliner in their Clemson recruiting class. And since ESPN began ranking recruiting classes back in 2006, Georgia's the first school to sign 20 of the ESPN top 300 in consecutive recruiting classes. Here's Phil Maffa. Now, I understand, to get back to the transfer portal thing, you know, everybody else is doing it.
Right.
Only the service academies aren't, and they can't get
people
in.
That's for unique reasons, right.
And I understand, you and I both admire the heck out of Dabo.
Love Dabo.
You know, he's a Hall of Fame. He never coached another game. He's going right into the College Football Hall of Fame. You know, he talks a lot about culture and, you know, loyalty and building a program. And he looks at his roster, he says, okay, we like our team. Is the guy we're going to bring in better? You know, I promised these recruits they'd come in here, we'd work with them, make them better, and help them achieve. They care about them as, you know, as men and as college students. I understand it, but, you know, it seems to me at least it could be a happy medium somewhere in between.
Yeah, I think you don't have to major in the portal, but you have to have a presence in the portal. And I think that's where Dabo will ultimately get. I understand they've always put a high premium on culture, dating all the way back. Dating all the way back to their times, beginning of his tenure, it's always been about culture. And hey, it's us against the world.
And it's real.
And it's real.
Go around a lot of places where they talk about it and they don't have it.
They literally love each other in that facility. And when you bring a guy in from the outside, it just takes one potentially to splinter a locker room. And that's something that's very dangerous. And I think he holds that near and dear to his heart. But when you've had injuries at times and the drop-off goes from where it was to where it becomes, when you have guys get banged up, you just don't have the depth if you don't have some veteran experience. that you can get out of the portal.
Seventh play of this drive for Clemson. There's Olsen, Pat Henry, part of their tight end group. Got three balls last year, now a sophomore from Naples. Well, last year, for context, across all of FBS football, 32% of the total starts on every team came from players who had transferred at some point in their career.
Right. I think a healthy approach would be the approach that Kirby Smart has taken. 12% of their starts are from portal players. Just a little bit, just so you don't become a freshman in the event of an injury.
And a nice play behind the line of scrimmage. Justin Williams, the freshman, getting an opportunity to play here late. And Georgia has culture too.
No question.
I was so impressed watching, and it was hard to watch the tape of last year's Capital One Orange Bowl again, because it was such an annihilation, and Florida State was such a no-show, literally. A lot of their players just didn't show up. You know, but Georgia could have done the same thing. You know what? We were going for a three-peat. We lost one game. We're number one all year. We didn't get in the playoff. We're going to sulk. Everybody who was healthy showed up. Ladd McConkey, who was injured most of the year and was heading to the NFL draft, showed up and played. Flag down behind the line of scrimmage. You know, they all wanted to go. Malachi Starks, knowing he had to have surgery, put off the surgery to go play in the bowl game because he wanted to finish it right and send the seniors off right. Georgia has a culture too. A great culture.
Phenomenal culture of guys that love football and tremendous accountability when it comes to approaching the game in a professional manner.
Holding offense number 71. That penalty's declined. Defense will take the result of the play, fourth down. There's also the 2-minute timeout.
34-3, Georgia. Clemson has gone 62 yards in 9 plays. They need to pick up 6 here on fourth down to keep the drive alive. Trying to take something positive out of this. Off the hands of Cole Turner and up in the air, an incomplete pass. And Georgia will take over on downs. It'll be back-to-back games without allowing a touchdown for Georgia as they gave up just 3 to Florida State in the Orange Bowl. Week 1 continues. Coming up in just a few minutes here on ABC, Miami with high hopes against Florida. And then tonight, a game we'll all be watching, number 7 Notre Dame against number 20 Texas A&M. Tomorrow on ABC, the Modelo Vegas Kickoff Classic, USC and LSU. And Monday at 7:30 on ESPN, Boston College begins the Bill O'Brien era against Florida State. Capital One Labor Day kickoff. Gunnar Stockton is the new quarterback, taking over for Carson Beck. And Chauncey Bowens is the ball carrier, making his debut. Carson Beck went 23 out of 33 for 278, 2 touchdowns. And I think showed, Greg, all the things that we've come to know from him. Good decision making, poise in the pocket, accuracy, and still adjusting to all the new pieces around him.
I think that's Kirby Smart's going to come back and look at this tape and absolutely be over the moon excited, because a couple years ago in 2021 or 2022, when they came into this game, they looked like the greatest football team we've ever seen when they beat Oregon the way they beat Oregon. This has not been a flawless performance by any stretch of the imagination. It's been really, really good, but there's so many things that just little things, little nuanced changes that they're going to want to make this camp. And I think it's going to be easier to do knowing when they watch the tape, there are those adjustments to be made.
I'd like to get your quick thought on tonight, Notre Dame and Texas A&M. The Mike Elko era begins. And against his quarterback from last year from Duke, Riley Leonard, who's transferred to South Bend.
I think he's got a pretty good feel for who Riley Leonard is, don't you think? But I think A&M's really talented. They've lacked some structure. They've brought in a couple guys in the portal that could take over the game tonight. But both teams tonight, Notre Dame and A&M, really big question marks along the offensive line. And knowing the D-line that A&M has and the D-line that the Irish have, I think that's going to be a low-scoring dogfight. And it might be the team that makes the fewest mistakes that ultimately wins it.
Very impressive opening win. 11 straight season openers won by Georgia, including all 9 now under Kirby Smart. And the
don't forget to subscribe.